Hi guys, welcome to another episode of Serena Loves TV on Focus TV Network. I'm your host, Serena Poon, and as you know, I'm incredibly passionate about helping others live their best life through methods I call culinary alchemy, which is the magic of combining education, integrative and functional nutrition with healing intuitive energy. So today, I'm incredibly honored to introduce a very special person who truly resonates and embodies this philosophy. He is a highly acclaimed, award-winning chef and restaurateur of 32 plant-based restaurants all across the globe. He is the author of 12 cookbooks. He's a speaker, he's an entrepreneur, he's an educator, and most accurately, he is a true visionary in the mission to create beautiful, sustainable, nutritious, and globally accessible plant-based cuisine. I'm so grateful to call him a friend, and I'm so grateful for his tireless effort in making this world a better, healthier place with his vision of crafting the future of food. Please welcome Matthew Kenney. Thank you so much for coming today.
So good to be here with you.
Thank you for making the time. I mean,
pleasure.
I appreciate it, but my audience really appreciate it. And you're so busy that this is amazing that you're here to share your story.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thanks so much.
So we both share such a love and passion for all the same things when it comes to achieving optimal health through food, you know, as a powerful healing and preventative tool for medicine, right? But we both pivoted from law to go into a career of culinary arts. And mine was because of my parents, that they were my inspiration. What was yours? You know, how did you decide to go from law into the culinary arts and get you started that way?
It was really the excitement of the food scene in New York and just doing something where I would connect with people on a more daily basis. I'm a little reserved, not maybe even a little bit shy. But I got to New York and I found that the restaurant scene was really the social scene. That was the sort of fabric of the city for me. And I would walk around the city looking in windows of restaurants. And it wasn't really about the food because I was always into health and wellness and exercise, but just the environment of preparing something fresh and the smells and the aromas and all the sensory experiences and people coming together for that purpose. I was just really attracted to that and, you know, kind of got into the food business because of that passion for what was taking place there.
Just how it brings everyone together and that kind of excitement with it.
It was that, but it was also the idea that someone operating a restaurant is kind of curating the whole experience, whether it's music or the cuisine or the uniforms people are wearing or the lighting.
Yeah.
I just really liked that ability to, you know, kind of curate an environment and express, which I didn't think that I was going to get in a more corporate world.
Right, that's true. So you started off classically trained. You went to the best schools, and you started off with restaurants that weren't actually plant-based, right?
Correct. I had been really into health and wellness. Like even in high school, I would get up at 5 a.m, go to the gym, or go running. And all through college, I kind of cooked my own meals because I was very much into healthier food. But in those days, plant-based wasn't seen as a healthier choice.
Right.
There wasn't really a lot of information about being sustainable as an athlete, or you know. Or attaining longevity due to a plant-based diet.
Right, people thought you were lacking if you did that, right?
Exactly, so I did what I thought was healthy, and I did my best to apply that to the cuisine. I was French trained, and that means a lot of butter, a lot of salt,
a lot
of cream. And at the same time, you know, I used the tools and techniques in that French cuisine to apply to a more hybrid, a very creative take on Mediterranean cuisine that I was inspired by when traveling.
So what made you kind of decide to dive into plant-based and this vision that you have? Because that's what I would love for you to really talk about, this crafting the future of food and everything that you're doing with your company.
It was a 15-year journey of preparing food that I felt was healthy, but at the same time, as I got more into yoga and more into meditation and more connected, I guess, to the planet and the alignment that is achievable if we make the right food choices, It happened slowly and then all at once. I was really ready for it, eating more and more plants in my own life, but still operating non-plant-based restaurants. And then one day somebody took me to a raw vegan restaurant in New York, and it just changed everything. I saw the people there and how passionate they were about what they were doing and the sort of glow on their skin and their eyes and started really listening deeply and also to my own sort of inner drive.
Yeah.
And I was just thinking, at the end of that meal, I walked around Manhattan and I started to think, if somebody can take this food and elevate it and do it in a comparable setting to the other type of restaurants that everybody loves, it could really be the next great thing with food.
Wow. So you had this one experience, and so you were actually already plant-based while you're still running non-plant-based restaurants?
No, not completely. I stopped eating meat. Right. I was eating very little dairy. Mm-hmm. I didn't consider myself vegan. I grew up, you know, in Maine, where I'd never heard the word vegan probably until I moved to New York. And even then, it was, you know, I moved there in the late 80s and the early 90s. It wasn't a big thing. Right. There was no such thing as an upscale vegan restaurant.
Right.
So I wasn't vegan, but I guess, you know, I was ready for it. And I was practicing yoga every day at a studio that really practiced alignment and plant-based way of life.
Yeah. So when you talk about alignment, I love that, because that's what brings it all together, right? That's what brings in what we put in our bodies and that's the mindfulness, all of it. So what does that mean to you when you say alignment?
Well, it means that the choices we're making when consuming food or preparing food mm-hmm. or buying it mm-hmm. are aligned with what's best for the planet. That doesn't just mean the environment, it means animals, it means our health, it means other people's health that you're cooking for.
Yeah.
And, you know, never felt completely right serving, you know, really rich, heavier foods, knowing somebody's going to go home and be uncomfortable or full and wake up the next day and not feel their best.
Yeah.
So a lot of it has to do with adjusting the palate, which I was able to do slowly on mm-hmm. my own, to the point where I could really enjoy food that was, to me, gourmet and delicious, mm-hmm. But still really doing what's best for the world.
Mm-hmm. It does. It takes a little time, because I myself started off classically trained like you. And so same thing with all the butters and the salts and the fats. And it does take a little bit of adjustment. And then you just realize that just what we have, just with the plants and herbs, are so powerful in flavor. You know, you don't really need any of that to cover it up. But this message that you're spreading, you know, I mean, there's so much that I would love for you to share about what you're doing with your business. I mean, you're not just in products and restaurants. I mean, you're teaching people, you've opened up schools. I would love to talk about that a little bit, this messaging.
Well, I realized early on, and this was one of the things that got me very, very excited about going plant-based. Mm-hmm. And of course, that was 10 years before the market was ready. But I really envisioned a lifestyle brand that could, you know, not only serve people a different style of food, but also show them how to prepare it through mm-hmm. books or classes, make products available. It's really like a whole ecosystem of a new way of eating. And I felt like the world really needed, you know, a lot of different options different touch points.
Yeah.
So I envisioned a very bold, broad, kind of global company from the very onset, because I felt like just doing one restaurant, it's limited, because people would come in and they'd like it, but they might live 3,000 miles away and also don't know how to prepare it. Mm-hmm. And even the people we were hiring in the kitchen didn't understand this type of cuisine. We could train them, mm-hmm. but I realized that chefs are taught to do the exact opposite. Mm-hmm. And I remember walking by my former culinary school one day, just after I had gone plant-based, mm-hmm. and the current students, this was years after I graduated, they were out in the back of the school smoking and drinking Cokes.
Yes.
And, you know, it just really like hit me, that one image really hit me that, you know, chefs have a responsibility mm-hmm. to do more.
Absolutely.
Not just make food taste good.
Right.
That's important too. It has to mm-hmm. taste good or we won't eat it. But it was kind of a lot of messages like that that really inspired me to try to do it more and on a larger scale.
Yeah. Because it's more, you had mentioned in one of your, I think, TED Talks about how we have a responsibility as chefs, where you can actually be serving up disease, right? If you're not serving the right combination of foods or the right foods. And is that part of what you teach?
Yeah, I tone it down. You know, it was a TED Talk, so it was a little bit sensationalist. I think I compared chefs to drug dealers, which in a way we are serving, you know, we're taught to serve foods that are addictive.
We are.
I mean, you know, I like salt, mm-hmm. and I used a generous amount when I was in culinary school, but the master chefs would come around and you know, say they taste it, more salt, more butter. And then the more you do that, the more you need, mm-hmm. and it covers up the true flavors of the cuisine. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's just one minor example.
Yeah.
But yes, I believe foods can be highly addictive, or at least, if not addictive, can change our palates to the point where we don't actually realize what is best for us. I'm not a doctor or a nutritionist. I'm really just going on intuition.
Right.
And so my goal was to really scale that back and try to do foods in their most natural way, with methods that would still be appealing to people. Because ultimately, everybody's a pleasure seeker.
Right. Well, I mean, as a nutritionist, and I've had your food in so many of your restaurants already, I think that your intuition serves you so well. It's spot on because it tastes amazing. And I feel that there, anytime I want someone to sample vegan or someone who's remotely considering or would never consider vegan, I take them to your places. I take them to your restaurants because I feel that your style of cuisine and your flavor profiles really kind of give insight to someone who thinks that, you know, being vegan means you're eating a lot of carrots and celery sticks. So, I mean, I guess could you, and a lot of it's proprietary, but give us a little bit of a hint, a secret of how you do that. You know, you have all these incredible techniques that aren't available in a lot of other restaurants, or they haven't adopted them yet.
Well, it's really three components to our food. I mean, we spend the most time whenever we go to a new market or even here, sourcing the best ingredients we can. Mm-hmm. So we shop a lot at the markets. We really work as seasonally as we can. We grow things when we can. We work with a lot of specialty providers to make sure we're getting the best almonds or the best oils. Mm-hmm. So that's really the first part of it, which a lot of chefs do. And, you know, thankfully more and more are paying attention to where the food comes from and organic when possible and so forth. Mm-hmm. But then the second part of it comes in, which are techniques and tools. So we've started to, many years ago, we started to use a lot of the same tools that at the time when molecular cuisine was popular, we started to use a lot of tools that were used in that kind of cuisine or contemporary cuisine, but just not with chemicals. So thermal immersion or sous vide, a lot of dehydration and smoking. We have some machine called an ultrasonic homogenizer, which emulsifies without heat or any type of blending mechanism. It's just ultrasound.
I've never used one of those before. I want to stop in.
We use Paco jets, not only just for making ice cream, but to do some other really cool things. So a lot of it, the tools and then the techniques associated with that. But we've also developed, and this comes from just trying so many things and failing at certain things and experimenting. And now we have a test kitchen, which is constantly trying to innovate and come up with new ideas. We come up with methods all the time that half the time it's a mistake. I mean, the first time we made the wrapper for our kimchi dumpling, that started as me trying to dehydrate a young coconut, blend of young coconut flesh to make it crispy. And I realized it's not getting crispy. So I took it out, set it aside, and realized that the texture was almost like a wonton, but it was made out of coconut. And then we decided we could add beet juice to that or celery juice or in the case of the kimchi dumplings, cilantro juice. And it would be bright green. And it would be pliable like a wrapper, and you could wrap it around like kimchi in this case. And it had a lot more flavor than just flour and water. So that's, you know, one of like 300 examples of things that we've been able to develop over time. And it just comes from trying and trying and trying and then also doing new concepts instead of just repeating them and scaling them, which we do that as well. But every time we develop a new concept or write a new book, it leads us into all these new ideas that we can actually then use certain components of those ideas to create others. So it just kind of extrapolates.
Yeah, well, so much mad genius too, you know, that's also part of it. I love that you, there's, you know, trying different methods, but there's also this, you have like a vision to what you want, and that's amazing. So you have all these restaurants. It's just crazy how much it's blown up just in the last few years. Can you talk about some of these projects that you have? And I know you'd mentioned, you know, now you're over at Four Seasons in Beverly Hills, and you have that, and you have products. Can you talk about a few of these projects with us?
Yeah, it's exciting. I mean, it felt like same way as my entry into plant-based cuisine. It felt like it was slow at first and then all at once, because in the early days it was really hard. The market wasn't ready for an upscale plant-based restaurant. We had a couple that didn't work and, you know, managed to keep it going just through just persistence and hard work. But a couple years ago, the market started to open up, and when we launched Plant Food and Wine on Abbot Kinney in California, that was a main stage. It was the first time that we'd actually done something on one of the best streets in a major city. So it opened us up to a new audience. And then from there we expanded, and we have, you know, a plant-based pizza concept, Double Zero, and a Mexican concept, Bar Verde, a couple of plant food and wines. We have concepts that are either operating, I guess a little under 20 operating. We have probably 15 in development, which could double by next year, because we're doing a lot of international projects with big hotel groups and other developers that, you know, want to take some of our concepts for multiple locations at the same time. So that's why we're growing faster now, because we have a lot of help with our international partners. They're, you know, building and doing that, it would take me forever to figure out how to construct a restaurant in Japan, for example.
But right.
when we have partners there who know how to do it and do it all the time,
right.
it's a lot easier for us to grow quickly.
So that's so we've got, you know, we've got people in the community that are all over the country and all over the world. So let us know some of the places that we can find your amazing cuisine.
Well, we have a lot in New York. Mm-hmm. We have 5 places in New York and another 7 coming in the next year.
Mm-hmm.
A lot downtown. We're doing something in Flatiron, which I hope to announce next week, which is part of a an apparel wear company that, you know, we've been working with for a while.
Oh, wow.
We're opening a big new concept in Brooklyn called Hungry Angelina, which will be like a 200-seat all-day restaurant.
Wow.
Really beautiful design mm-hmm. with an architect from Spain. We're expanding 00 into Brooklyn and Boston and Santa Monica, Venice.
Everywhere.
Philadelphia, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
And a couple of really exciting projects. We are partners in a new concept called Humble, without the E, H-U-M-B-L, and it's going to be a very fast casual concept. Really beautiful branding, fun menu. First 2 locations will be in the Orlando area.
Oh, okay.
And that's a, you know, 5-10 minute experience, but it's really nice. I feel good about it. We're not using processed ingredients and very, very clean, but it's meant for people on the go and a younger crowd or any age crowd, but you know, it's a lot of students and so forth.
Yeah.
And that's on the sort of more casual end of the spectrum, but on the highest end of the spectrum, we're doing Sentio, which is it means to experience or to feel. Sentio is a tasting menu only restaurant we're doing in New York that will only seat 24 people at a time.
Oh, wow.
It's pretty big, but it's very, it's a highly curated experience that will change with the seasons. And that will be like a 12 or 15 course experience. And there are few other elements to it as well that are exciting. But we're in Canada, in Edmonton. We're opening more in Canada. We're in South America. We're in Buenos Aires with Sacro.
Mm-hmm.
We're in Bogota with Makeout. We're opening Plant Made in Sao Paulo next month.
Mm, wow.
And we're doing another location of Makeout in Costa Rica.
Oh, okay.
We're also doing a hotel in Costa Rica that won't open for a couple years.
Yeah, that's so exciting. And the whole hotel will be plant-based? And
this entire hotel will be, it's going to be an upscale, really beautiful, like 20-room, 20-villa hotel, wellness facility and restaurant.
Amazing.
And we're in a few other countries. We're in the Middle East and Australia, Sydney.
Mm-hmm.
And the list just kind of goes on. We have more projects. I have to write it down.
I'm like, it's probably hard for you to even keep track. And then you have tangible products that people can order, right? Order online and purchase. That's upcoming.
Yes, we have 5 different products in development. One is being launched at Expo West. It's the biggest one, and we'll announce it in a week or two.
I'm going to be there.
It will be over 30, I think it's about 30 different products in that line, and we're excited to launch it there on March 7th.
Okay.
We have Antidote, which is our bar. It's a partnership with a really wonderful doctor partner and friend of mine, and that's coming out in a couple weeks. We keep tweaking it.
Until it's perfect.
And Siva, which is a pumpkin seed-based beverage, is another brand. And then later in the year, we're doing our pizza, 00 Pizza Frozen, which will be nationwide. And a cheese concept as well. Like something really, I think, very innovative. And we have a lot of other things in media. We do services. We have a lot of different agreements. We're starting to work with hospitals, and eventually we'll do work with schools and you know, other areas of education. So it's all tied together to the product we do. We just deliver that product or that idea through different channels.
So a couple things, you know, before we wrap up, there's so many people in, well, not just my audience and community, but just everywhere they have visions, you know, and they're not sure how to start. And they're maybe in careers and they just sort of want to pivot to putting effort and energy into their passion. Do you have any sort of like maybe 1 or 2 pieces of advice from your experience that you can give to someone who's sort of looking to make that change?
I mean, I think it's really important to, I always try to think about where I want to go with it. Like what we're doing with our company now, it's very hard. And at the same time, I'm grateful, but I'm not surprised, because my large scale vision, and didn't know if it would take 5 years or 20 years. It wasn't a 5-year plan or a 3-year plan. Didn't have a specific number of restaurants, but in terms of the brand and the scale, I knew exactly what I wanted, even when we had one restaurant that was barely surviving.
Wow.
I still knew where it could potentially go.
Right.
And the most important thing at that moment was doing the best I could with what I was working on. The other things can wait, we'll get to them. but really sticking to an idea, I find that if you just, you know, and it may not work. I mean, try again. Mm-hmm. But persistence, obviously, it sounds like cliche, but it's so important to keep going. True. And not every day is easy. There are so many days that are really challenging, and those days are just as important as the ones where everything's going great.
Yeah.
And I think developing a personal style is really important, especially in this plant-based market, because so many people are coming into it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, having a personal style and an ethos that you can change over time, but at least try to stay with it.
Yeah.
And, you know, have your own voice. I think that's really important too.
That's great advice. It really is. Just sort of like dream big, put it out there, but stay focused and just take one step at a time. And there's really no failure, because every time that there is a little setback, it's a lesson.
I read this book, Built to Last. It's a business book that a lot of people were reading in the 80s. And they studied companies that had stood the test of time and grown a lot. And one thing they had in common was, they called it like, I don't know even how you pronounce it, Bags or something, BHAGS.
Okay.
Big, hairy, audacious goals.
Uh-huh.
Doesn't mean that they're pie in the sky or completely insane, but goals that are realistic but very, very bold.
Yeah.
And that has to be communicated to everybody that you're working with, even if you're a team of one.
Mm-hmm. That's great. I love that. And, you know, we have to wrap up, but at least tell us where we can find, you have so many different social handles, I think, for all your different products and restaurants, but let us know where we can find you, at least, and your website.
Well, we, Matthew Kenney, www.matthewkenneycuisine.com is our website, and every business we have lives on one platform.
Okay.
It's a couple hundred pages of info on there, but everything is there. And I'm not on social as much as I would love to be, because it's addictive, but I do have an Instagram account, Matthew Kenney Cuisine, and it flows through to a business Facebook account and a Twitter, but I post now and then when I can.
Perfect. Well, thank you so much for coming. It was
I appreciate everything
you're
doing.
Thank you. It's been so great. And thank you so much for joining us at Serena Loves TV. This is Matthew Kenney, and we'll see you guys next time.